Good morning, boys and girls. This is Mr. Moyer, and I hope you have enjoyed your 3 days off of school. I wanted to share you this slideshow since we're kind of short on our week leading up to the Super Bowl. There were a few more things that I wanted to talk to you about in terms of our critical media literacy lessons. So had we been in school these past couple of days, I was going to share with you the things that we were doing. I'll do a quick review just to kind of get you warmed up, particularly after such a cold couple of days. And I know it's early when I am giving this to you. I hope you're all still in bed and your parents let you sleep in. But I know it's been a couple of days of doing some good thinking, so I thought, well, I would share this to you virtually and give you an opportunity to do a little good thinking here, particularly leading up to our Super Bowl weekend. So, of course, this week we had been talking about advertising again, and I called it super advertising, obviously, in relation to the Super Bowl, and that was one of the first things that we talked about. You know, so this is always a good opportunity for us to review one of the main questions that we do when we deconstruct media. And it's question number four, and it's about values. So, you know, before the winter break, we had been looking at commercials, and I'd asked you, you know, well, what are values? And we defined that earlier this week as it's a person's principles or standards of behavior, but more largely just what's one's judgment of what is important in life. So, you know, what do we really value, not just in terms of money, though we talked about that, but just what do we believe? What do we feel? What do we feel are the most important things for us to do? And of course, we get a lot of input in our lives about what is valuable or what we're supposed to value. And media is just one of those. So that's obviously why we want to talk about this. You know, you get adults telling you all the time, probably, you know, hey, this is what's important. You should be paying attention to this. This is what's meaningful. But we want to pay attention that media is doing the same thing. And particularly since we spend a lot of time with media, then we should be cautious about what kind of values it's giving us. Now, we talked about some examples of these, right? Well, first and foremost, we should understand when we're talking about advertising, commercialism is definitely one of those values. What's being shared here is not just a, hey, you should buy this, but you know, we really examine this as, you know, it's important that you buy this. Like, you need to have these things. You need to have these things in order to feel good about yourself, or you need to have these things in order to be successful. That's that idea of commercialism, not just that, hey, would you buy? I'm trying to persuade you, but also, you know, making you feel like you need to have those things. We also talked about gender stereotypes. You can't get away from, you know, watching some of these things and saying, oh, well, that's, you know, confirming some of these gender stereotypes that we talked about for boys or for girls, or it's maybe going against some of those gender stereotypes. So, you know, once we have an idea that that's something that goes on, now we can begin to see that actually pop up quite a bit in some of the commercials that we look for. You know, I asked you for some examples that you've seen in your media that you've collected so far. And, you know, I added one last one to our list here because I think particularly, you know, when we talk about sports and, you know, just kind of using this as an example with the Super Bowl, obviously, sometimes the value that's being put out there is like, hey, this is entertainment. You know, we're here to have a good time and you should forget about everything else. This is just a feel good time. And that's a value. You know, that's what somebody is trying to promote for you. Maybe when they give you, well, it could be the advertisement. I'm sure we'll all enjoy some of the advertising, but also particularly like, you know, the actual event that we'll be watching, maybe the Super Bowl. So I shared a couple of examples. And if you want to use these examples for your assignment that I'll describe later on, then you're more than welcome to use these. I shared this one in class as well as the Budweiser commercial. But, you know, one of the first things we talked about, and I know this is an activity that we already completed in class, but just as a review, you know, we looked at, you know, when you see these commercials coming up in the Super Bowl, they've averaged $5 million for a 30-second spot. You know, I think we often come across big numbers, and sometimes I don't think we give them the respect, I suppose, that they deserve. So, you know, we did an activity in class where I asked you, okay, what's the opportunity cost of this particular thing? Okay, so I was trying to get you to focus on what we spend our money on. Now, of course, I'm using the term we, as none of us spend $5 million of our own money on these commercials. But what we mean here is an opportunity cost is just simply, if you spend money on, say, that Super Bowl commercial, then you're not having it to spend on other things. And I know that this was money from a company and they could have spent it on other things, but I tried to get us to understand, well, if we put that in perspective, just about other things that are going on, and I'm making a big connection outside of, you know, directly where that money was coming from, but just simply saying, if we really looked at the way that money is happening in the United States, you know, and I tried to use this very funny example of, okay, let's just boil this down to something simple. If there was 100 people, and I used the fifth grade as like, you know, kind of a model of that, and we had 100 jelly beans, I tried to put it in this perspective that this is how many jelly beans certain people would be getting. Now, bear in mind, the richest one person, only one person would end up getting 35 of those jelly beans. Already, they got a pretty big chunk of that. Now, I'm sure I would like to be that richest one person getting 35 of those jelly beans, but unfortunately, I am not. And I wanted you to see this kind of in this perspective, because that was our gateway to talking about, okay, there are people who are less fortunate than many of us probably in Centerville. And not to say that we're all of the same means even in Centerville. One thing that we have to pay attention to sometimes about, you know, differences amongst people is that, you know, different families have different financial means. And so later on, I'll talk about socioeconomic status maybe as an example. But, you know, we looked at this, and I was using this because this came across, you know, my radar as I was planning this lesson, that, you know, this kind of shows there are a lot of people in the greater Cincinnati area, this is kind of close to where I live, that are living in poverty. So, you know, we did the exercise where we were looking at, okay, well, the United Way, which is a nonprofit organization that tries to help folks who are in poverty. What if we could trade that one 30-second commercial? What would we get? Could we just, let's say we'll take one of those commercials out of the Super Bowl, and instead we'll use that to do something good for people in our community that might have a little bit less. So we did some of these calculations, and my hope is, of course, I want to talk about those when we get back maybe to school together to check our math and see what we're looking at. But once again, I think you have to respect what kinds of numbers this actually comes out to be. There's a whole bunch of meals that we could provide for families. There's many weeks of shelter that we could provide for families. And in particular, like, I want to make the connection that, you know, a lot of you enjoy after school activities, sports, or music lessons, or other kinds of enrichment things that your parents, you know, choose for you to enrich your life and make you a well-rounded person. You know, sometimes families who are poor don't have those means. And, you know, this could provide a whole bunch of those experiences for kids. Plus, when we talked about, and I think some of you even brought up in class, like, you know, training somebody for a job that would not only provide them something now, but for something long-term, you know, we could provide a whole bunch of that for people. So, you know, that $5 million, that maybe that just doesn't sound like a lot off the top of your head, but I'm hoping this math actually kind of showed that to you in some ways. Okay, now, I wanted you to like pause and really kind of consider this, okay? So, you know, when you think about how many commercials there will be during the Super Bowl, and think about actually how much money that actually adds up to, it's a pretty impressive amount. Okay, so maybe we'll talk more about this in our discussion, but this could also be something maybe you'd want to write about in your blog post, is that that's a pretty impressive amount. So you think about what we get for one commercial versus, hey boy, let's just say one commercial break where we might see five or six commercials. Wow, just think about how much that could provide. So there's another aspect to this that I wanted to bring up, and that was the fact that advertising seems to be all around us. And I know we had fun kind of looking at some advertisements prior to the holiday, you know, and particularly, you know, picking like some sort of, I called it a toy ad, but many of them weren't necessarily toys that we looked at. But I just thought I'd kind of add this in here because there are some fun things I think to think about or consider, you know, when it comes time for advertising. So, you know, speaking of sports events, I last weekend was watching the NHL All-Star Game. And so I just want to play you just a little bit of a clip from the game. This is just a section of highlights from the game. But what I want you to do is I want you to think about if there are any advertisements that come up during this clip. So here we go. Oh, no, I don't think it played. Let's go back. Let me see if I can get it to play. There we go.
It's a lot of fun, and you can tell just from from the noise coming from the great people here at the Shark Tank right now that they are excited for this All-Star game. They get to see the best players in the league go head-to-head in three-on-three action.
All Sharks are starting. They are the three, Pavelski and Burns and Carlson. And steaming on ahead, score! A happy humans here in San Jose, and the Pacific gets on the board. Hometown hero Eric Carlson. So now Burns delays for another change from his bench, and a steal, and O'Reilly is way out of his hurry, and O'Reilly has scored. Right now you are seeing on the ice, and on is McDavid. Oh, what a save made by Dubnyk. Goodness. I don't care where you're playing, these San Jose fans appreciate that.
Okay, let's pause there, and let's see if you caught some of those advertisements. Did you notice any of these? The thing about hockey, as well as many other sports, is that advertisers pay for space within that actual arena, the place where the game is going, and sure, you're probably paying maybe attention to where the puck is going, or where the player is going, or where the ball is going, but advertisers also know that people in the stands, as well as the people watching from home, have their eyeballs on the screen, and that there are going to be opportunities for them to make an advertisement. So there's a lot of in-game advertising actually that is going on, which you might not necessarily think about. Now, what I think also kind of funny is, did you notice that when I played that clip from YouTube, that there was an ad within YouTube that popped up? So, you know, like even just the viewing the advertising through YouTube itself was wanting to send me some advertising. So there's a lot of advertising that is going on. And, you know, we talked about this in class, and I thought I'd bring this back up that, you know, particularly when it comes time for the NFL, though I don't know if you caught it, if you can go back and watch that little clip of the NHL game, there also was an NHL advertisement for the military. And I was actually kind of shocked to learn this because, you know, I think like you, it just seems kind of a natural part of like most NFL games or other sporting events, because I've been to several where we honor people in the military. And I think it always feels very good, always brings a nice standing ovation to see veterans who have been, you know, brought back or recognized during, you know, maybe a game for their service. Which, you know, I think many of us said, well, that's a wonderful thing to be able to do. But then to actually figure out that the Defense Department, the military, paid the NFL to actually do that, then you almost have to consider that, well, that itself is a kind of advertising. And so the article here I found from PBS listed they paid $4.5 million from 2011 to 2014. Interesting, we're back to that almost $5 million amount, right? So again, you could consider all those things that we looked at could have been spent on, let's say, something else to help people who are less fortunate than ourselves. Not to say that we shouldn't honor the military during those, you know, particular sporting events, but just to consider that, you know, that could have been done out of the goodness of the NFL's heart, but you know, it is also a business. So they're expecting to, you know, maybe be paid for some of that time for people who want to advertise. Now, what's really interesting about this is if you consider this, is that where does the government, the military get money? Well, that's from taxpayers like you and I. So that you know, now when I say this isn't some company who's spending $5 million, this is actually our federal government who is spending that much money on that. So something to consider. That's rather interesting. Now, there's one other thing that I want to talk about here, which I thought was kind of fascinating, and that is I want to talk a little bit about ad placement. And so since many of us spent a lot of time online, not just, you know, viewing media through television or movies, I thought I'd bring this one up. And particularly last year, I noticed a lot of fourth graders were playing games at coolmathgames.com. And so, I was always fascinated by looking over their shoulder and seeing, oh, did you recognize any of the advertisements there? Now, I want you to look closely and see if you can find where the advertisements are on here. And then look closely at my tabs that I have open up there, because I wanted to prove something to you. And that's this. So when I was looking at this particular game. It didn't take me very long. What I did is I first went on a line and did a couple searches, and then I went over to coolmathgames.com, and then I started playing a game. And of course, I'm not very good at the game, but here's what I want to point out to you. My search that I did prior to playing the game was about going on a Canadian train trip, which I did this past summer. So I just did a couple quick searches, and then when I went to the game, guess what kind of ad showed up? Exactly the same place I had just been searching. Now, why did they know that? Well, that's because they're kind of following what I'm doing. People pay for these advertisements and want to direct it directly to people. So, and I don't know if you recognize that a lot of advertising is being directed towards you. And you know, this shows up in all kinds of places, all kinds of websites that we might end up going to. But that's a really interesting thing to kind of consider. You know, we'll later talk about who are ads kind of directed at. Well, you know, you now know that, you know, as maybe you're working online that, you know, I didn't have to sign in. I didn't have to say anything about who I was, but it certainly knew what I was searching so that it presented me with this ad. So that's something to consider. Now, I'm using this broadly to talk about how widely spread advertising is. And, you know, we watched the movie Consuming Kids in class, and there's one little section about product placement. And I thought it was a kind of funny one, though I decided I was going to use another clip to kind of talk about this. And so product placement is when you see an actual brand in a movie, that's not an accident. Many times advertisers will pay to have their product inserted into a particular movie. And you won't even know it as an advertisement. So again, you know, like why I'm bringing this all up because there's sometimes advertisements that sneak into things, right? So product placement is kind of a name for that. When we see a brand or like something, like you can definitely tell Doritos is happening, you know, in this particular clip. And so I'll play the clip and so you can see exactly, because it's so prevalent. A long time ago, this movie Wayne's World, which is an older movie, but they were making fun of product placement. So I think you'll probably get that they're being kind of facetious when they do this. So here we go. Let's take a look. Oh, yes. Another ad.
Well, the squirrels are back in the attic.
Mom? If you're a mom, you call it the worst time. It's what you do. If you want to save 15% or more on car insurance, you switch to Geico. It's what you do.
Where are you? It's very loud there.
Listen, we need to have a talk about Vanderhoff. The fact is, he's the sponsor, and you signed a contract guaranteeing him certain concessions, one of them being a spot on the show.
Well, that's where I see things just a little differently. Contract or no, I will not bow to any sponsor.
Except Pizza Hut.
Sorry you feel that way, but basically it's the nature of the beast.
Maybe I'm wrong on this one, but for me, the beast doesn't include selling out.
By putting advertisements in your movie.
Garth? You know what I'm talking about, right?
It's like people only do things because they get paid. And that's just really sad.
I can't talk about it anymore. It's giving me a headache.
Here, take two of these.
Ah, Nuprin. Little. Yellow. Different. Look, you can stay here in the big leagues and play by the rules. Or you can go back to the farm club in Aurora. It's your choice.
Yes. And it's the choice of a new generation.
So most product placements aren't quite that obvious, but they're obviously using that to make fun of them. So I really encourage you, like maybe next time you watch a TV show or a movie, just look and see what brands are there. They're not there by accident. Somebody has decided that needs to be put into the movie. There isn't any movie or any media that isn't a constructed message, isn't a constructed piece of media. It always has been carefully thought through. Everybody who decides what goes into it has made some decisions. So it's not an accident and it's not a natural thing. That's one of the things that we talk about first off bat is that it is created. It isn't something that just happens naturally. All right. So
and you signed a contract.
Sorry. There we go. So one more time, just to kind of review some of the things that we're looking at here. We've talked about values once more. We've talked about some of our examples, and we've seen that happen in all different kinds of advertising. So, you know, the big thing is here, my hope is that we can start to see not just the small parts, these individual things, you know, look at this one commercial or this one commercial, but then we can kind of step back somewhat and we can begin to see these things in the larger picture. So, you know, I started off with this lesson or this experience by talking about here are these Super Bowl commercials. And sure, we've had these experience maybe with these before. We've seen these before. We've seen advertisements before. But now I tried to connect that in a different way to talk about what's the economic impact of that. You know, $5 million for one commercial during the Super Bowl. You know, what does that mean to us in our community? What could that $5 million done differently than just give us one more 30-second commercial? So, you know, what we're doing is we're doing an analysis, a critical analysis, you might say, in some ways. And what I mean by that is that, you know, we're kind of breaking down what's there. I know we like that term of, you know, what we're doing, deconstructing, breaking down. That's what an analysis is, but sometimes it's good to have this mindful way of seeing. So, I try and always connect that back to some of the things that we've done in classes, you know, being able to see what's there, what is everything that's there. Let's look and look again, and let's make some connections that wouldn't be obvious connections, perhaps. You know, I think it's probably pretty rare that anybody who watches the Super Bowl immediately thinks, oh, gosh, this commercial cost $5 million. What else could we do with that money? You know, we probably take the commercial at face value. We laugh. We feel a little emotional. You know, it's going to give us some sort of entertainment. And we don't normally think about that. But that's been my goal all along, is just to get us to think about it, to slow down and say, wow, there's a lot of stuff that's actually happening here. And let's pay attention to that. What do we know about that? How do we feel about that? Would we want to do anything differently about that? So that's kind of what we've been aiming at all along. Now, there was two sides to the paper that I had given you in class. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually attach another copy of this document when I email this to family. So in case you need a copy of this, you certainly can. I would imagine you didn't take it home with you. But here's the kind of homework that I was hoping that maybe you would do. I would hope that you would maybe watch the Super Bowl, you know, the day of. It is one of those big major American cultural events. And I know that many of you said, it's not something we do in our family, and that's absolutely fine. But what I'm hoping is that maybe you would be able to even pull some Super Bowl ads, either from this slideshow, or if you want to go out and do a quick search even after the Super Bowl, because some of those will be released onto YouTube and other places. I was hoping that you would watch it with somebody. And then, of course, you'd fill out this sheet and then do a blog post about this afterwards. And so there's a couple things just to consider as you do this. All right. So we've talked about five deconstruction questions. And my hope is that you really kind of focus in these areas, because it seems to me like, you know, as a class as a whole, when we look at deconstructing, we're pretty good about 1, 2, and 5, but it's really that 3 and 4 that I want us to focus on. So in this particular case, I'm hoping that you'll watch a Super Bowl commercial with a person who's different than you, and then just compare your reactions and your observations to that, you know, to really get us in that mindset that, you know, different people are going to experience that media differently than us. You know, we're going to see some things, they're going to see some things that might be a little bit different, they might be the same. And then even to think, you know, that doesn't even cover the full story, that there is going to be lots of different opinions that are out there. And then for us to think about the values that these ads are promoting, whether it's directly in just that, hey, would you buy this car? Hey, would you look at these clothes? Or hey, would you use this app? But also, are there some gender stereotypes that are going on in here? What other kinds of values might be they promoting? What do they get us to think about? So, you know, in terms of different, I'd shared this slide before, and I was going to talk about this a little bit more in class. You know, when we talk about people who are different, or you know, like somebody who is other than us, you know, there's I like this list. You know, there's a lot of different ways we could talk about difference. And the first thing that many of us latched onto was the difference between somebody who is knows an inside thing and somebody who doesn't know an inside thing. So, you know, Michael talked about like tuner culture. And so again, if you didn't even know what that term is, well, then you're on the outside of that culture, and somebody maybe who does know that term is on the inside. We talked about Jacob's notion of Leica. If you knew the story of Leica, then you could look at that picture and know some things. If you didn't know who Leica was, as a dog and like a story, well, then you would look at that picture and see it differently. And that again, is not something that's on my list, but that's like another category you guys could think of. But sometimes then when we look at the world and when we look at people, we've kind of sectioned people off in different ways. Well, here are seven different ways that sometimes we've sectioned people off. And so the socioeconomic status is the one that I was, you know, kind of alluding to a little bit at the beginning of this lesson, which was, you know, hey, there are people out there who are below the poverty level and do not have a lot of economic means. They don't have enough money in their family to do some of the things that you and I do in our daily lives. So, you know, that's something we should be aware of and think about that, gosh, if I was watching some of those commercials and I could never maybe afford enough money to buy that car or to wear those clothes or you know, participate in that consumer culture in some way, I would probably look at those commercials as being a little bit different. And then I don't know, maybe that $5 million that was being spent on a commercial would seem a little awkward to me. But so there's a lot of different ways in which you can kind of pick somebody who's different than you. But I realize a lot of you are going to end up picking somebody who is close to you in your family, like I said, that you could watch maybe the Super Bowl with. And again, remember, I said it doesn't have to be directly with that person. But if you want to do it with somebody remotely, like, you know, grandma or grandpa lives a couple states away and they're not going to be with you at the same time to watch the Super Bowl commercial, maybe we could somehow, you know, share that with them in some ways and talk with them about that. But my hope is that you'll pick somebody who's convenient, obviously, for you maybe to talk with and chat with. But, you know, it's kind of nice to maybe go out and see what are some differences. And so these might be some ways in which you would consider a different person. Now, you know, every time we look at media, I want to add this different kind of perspective on it. I've used the term that these are lenses before, or a different way of looking at things. And I think those five ways, those five questions, deconstruction questions that we use with analyzing media are great. But I also want to add another component to that. And so I think actually all five of these that I've shared are going to be interesting. Well, first of all, you know, you're going to be sharing maybe this media, these advertisements with somebody who is quote unquote different than you. And this is an opportunity for you to really, you know, think about, okay, well, here's how I thought about it, but boy, here's how somebody else might think about it. The second was to notice interdependence. And I think that this is a rather interesting one because now I hope you're starting to see that this commercial isn't just one commercial by itself. This media, any piece of media, isn't just this piece of media by itself. It relies on understandings of other things. It relies on you interpreting it as an audience member. You know, it might have a message, but the way that you take that message could be very different. So see, that media doesn't mean the same thing to everybody because of who sees it. There's a lot of different ways that interdependence is woven into the way that we think about media. The third thing is to expect change. And I know a lot of you have talked about, well, sometimes I like things and then now I won't. But it is really interesting to think about how that could mean a lot of different things. It could mean this commercial today makes a lot of sense. It might be funny today. Tomorrow it might not be. It might be funny for some people, but then that might change as a result. There could be a lot of different ways in which we think about this as changing. You know, Super Bowl commercials today are not the same as what Super Bowl commercials were like maybe 5, 10, 15, 20, 25 years ago. The act intentionally part, I think, is a really good one because, you know, I think a lot of times, you know, we view these things and then we just are pretty passive in how we view them, how we think about them. We just kind of internalize our messages. You know, there's a lot of different ways in which you can act intentionally here. You know, you can have a response to these. You know, you can say something about these, say, oh, I didn't like that, or I did like that. I thought that was great, or this was not what I wanted. And, you know, above all, one of the things that we can do to act intentionally is we can say, I just choose not to watch. And some of you seem to have maybe indicated, you know, your family just says, this is something that's not necessarily valuable for us. We've chosen not to watch this. So that could be something too. That's mostly what I tend to do with the Super Bowls. I just say, I'm not really that interested in it. I'm going to choose to not do this. The last one is about you and community. And I think this last one is a really good one. And I want to come back to some of the things that a lot of you have brought up previously in some of your deconstructions. And that's how you feel maybe about this particular message. And I want to extend that a little bit to say, okay, we've had like this big broad experience and maybe you've never ever thought about that $5 million, the cost of a commercial. So some of these things might be new to you. And I just want to invite you to say, How do you feel about this? There's no right or wrong answer to these questions. It's just, I'm trying to get you to be a little bit more aware of yourself and aware of everything that might be going on when we view media. And lastly, I wanted you to say, okay, well, you know, now that you think about this, how do you feel about this as part of your community? And I'm using that term very broadly, you know, like if we think about the Super Bowl as being part of American culture, whether it's something that you particularly watch or not, you just know that that's something that is obviously valued, quote unquote, in our community, because one, advertisers want to pay so much money for it. Two, because a lot of people end up watching this. Three, because it's a sporting event, and sports are held up in American culture as something that is something that's valuable. Whether that's your belief or not, you can't help but recognize that this is a big part of who we are as Americans. So, you know, when you think about that, then how do you feel about that being such an important part? Are there other things that you would rather see money or attention being spent on? So that's kind of what I mean by that last one. And again, there's no right or wrong answers to this. I'm not looking for a particular answer from you. I'm just wanting to know, can you think in that way? Can you begin to see things in that way and not feel like just because you're 10 or 11 that you're not allowed to have a response to that or a thought about that? Because I think I want you to. I think that that's what makes you an informed and empowered person in your community, is that you really think about things. You can look at things and see a lot that's in there. And you can feel like, yeah, you get a chance to respond to that in some way. You can say something about that. You can make decisions in your own life and in talking with people in your community about what you find valuable and what you would like to see that makes our community a better place for everybody, for you and for everybody. So that's in a nutshell. I hope you have enjoyed, like I said, your 3 days off. I hope you enjoy your weekend. I hope that you'll get a chance to ask questions. If you have any questions, I'll keep an eye out on email this weekend. But I look forward to seeing you maybe back on Monday after the Super Bowl and us getting a chance to talk a little bit more about some of your experiences. Be well. Enjoy, guys. I miss you. We'll talk to you later. Bye.